nerd out about sulforaphane with you? I would love to. Sulforaphane is probably the most famous isothiocyanate. So this is a class of really unique sulfur-containing phytonutrients found in the cabbage family vegetables, cruciferous vegetables. And what's really special about sulforaphane is it's not sitting around in broccoli just waiting for you to eat it. It isn't actually formed until we crush or chew broccoli and we actually start breaking apart the cell so that an enzyme that is specifically housed within the vacuole of the plant cell can break free and meet the glucosinolate precursor. In this case, it's glucoraphanin. So when glucoraphanin and myrosinase meet, they form this isothiocyanate, sulforaphane, and sulforaphane is amazing for us. Sulforaphane has been shown to reduce risk of cancer through multiple mechanisms, reduce risk of cardiovascular disease, reduce risk of neurodegenerative disease. It's potently anti-inflammatory. It improves insulin sensitivity in type 2 diabetics. Sulforaphane even inhibits the growth of Helicobacter pylori, the bacteria associated with stomach ulcers, and that increases risk of gastrointestinal cancers. But here's where things get interesting. Cooking deactivates the enzyme myrosinase. So if you don't make the myrosinase and the glucoraphan mix before cooking, do you get sulforaphane? The answer is no, not so much. So there was a 2008 study that compared how much sulforaphane got into our bloodstream after eating raw broccoli versus cooked broccoli. And they calculated the bioavailability of sulforaphane to be 37% in raw broccoli, but only 3.4% in cooked broccoli. Now, a 2018 study tested what if you mash up that broccoli into a bajillion 2 millimeter sized pieces, let it sit out for 90 minutes so the myrosinase can do all of its magic, and then stir fry the broccoli. And they found an increase in sulforaphane of 2.8-fold compared to mashing it up and then stir frying right away. So that time for myrosinase to do its thing, super awesome. So on the surface, we might look at these data and say, we should be eating cruciferous vegetables like broccoli and kale and Brussels sprouts raw in order to chew them up and crush them and make that myrosinase meet all of the glucosinolate precursors in order to form the most isothiocyanates in order to benefit from these vegetables, but not so fast. Because we also have gut bacteria that can produce myrosinase that help make these isothiocyanates so we can still get the same benefits from cooked cruciferous vegetables. And there's a whole collection of studies that have had human volunteers consume high levels of cruciferous vegetables daily for like 2 weeks and measured a big increase in these myrosinase producing bacteria over that 2 week time span. So when you consume cruciferous vegetables on a regular basis, even if you mainly consume them cooked, you're gonna have a gut microbiome that's gonna help you get more benefits from those cruciferous vegetables. And then it doesn't matter whether you eat them raw or cooked. And this is why studies that look at how cruciferous vegetable intake impacts all-cause mortality, which is used in medical research as a general indicator of health and longevity, used as an indicator as to whether or not something is good or bad, show that for every 100 grams, that's a serving and a half of cruciferous vegetables we consume daily, risk of all-cause mortality decreases by 10 to 12%, depending on the study you're looking at. So the main take-home message here is that no matter how you like cruciferous vegetables, that's the best way to eat them. Yes, you'll get more isothiocyanates formed if you eat them raw or if you just pulverize them and let them sit on your counter for 90 minutes before cooking them. But consuming them regularly will mean that you have a gut microbiome that will do that same job for you. So however you like them, go for it.